Hello and welcome from me, Mike Scott, in Oxford in the UK, and from my co-conveners, Catherine Temple and Joe Simmons in Washington, DC. This is the 12th event in this new series, which is a follow-on from the Christian Literary Imagination series and our earlier series, Christian Shakespeare Question Mark, which is now available as a book published by Vernon Press. And I'm delighted to tell you that Vernon Press is also wishing to publish the Christian Literary Imagination series talks, but more of that at a later date. And another thing I'm delighted to tell you is that my co-convener, Joe Simmons, has just been awarded his DPhil at Oxford University. So many congratulations to you, Joe. Delighted for you. Well, all three of these series are part of Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. In a moment, Catherine Temple will introduce today's speakers, Shiloh Krupar and Sarah Kanouse, who are going to talk to us today. Your participation is as important as ever, so please type in any questions you have by using your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Please use your Q&A button and do not use the chat button. You can do this from the moment we begin the session, and we will endeavour to answer your questions in the discussion towards the end of the event. Ensure, please, it's the Q&A button, not the chat one. Over to you, Catherine.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mike. I'm very excited to welcome our two speakers today. Sarah Kanouse is Associate Professor of Media and Arts at Northeastern University and an interdisciplinary artist and writer, very much in keeping with the purpose of the series. Her research-based creative projects shift the visual dimension of the landscape to allow stories of environmental and social transformation to emerge. Her work has been presented through the Haus der Kulturen der Welt, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago, the Krannert Art Museum, and numerous academic and artist-run venues. And then my colleague, Shiloh Krupar, is a geographer and provost, a distinguished associate professor at Georgetown University, where she directs the Culture and Politics Program in the School of Foreign Service. Her research examines the biopolitical administration of asymmetrical life, geographies of waste and vulnerability, and bureaucracy. She is the author of Hot Spotters Report, Military Fables of Toxic Waste, 2013, and the co-author of Deadly Biocultures, The Ethics of Life-Making. So with that, I will welcome them, and I believe they're going to share screen, and I'm really looking forward to hearing what both of them have to say. Thank you so much.
Thanks so much for the invitation to be here. Before we begin our presentation, I want to first acknowledge that I'm speaking from the territory of the Massachusetts people and their lineal descendants, the Massachusetts tribe at Ponkapog, on whose land I live and work. Such an acknowledgement is a necessary but inadequate step toward being in right relation with the land that sustains me and the people whose traditional and ongoing care has enabled my presence here today.
And I too acknowledge that I'm speaking from the territory of the Nacotchtank people and their descendants, the Piscataway Kanoi people, on whose land I live and work. Again, an inadequate symbolic gesture, but nonetheless important, especially as we engage in virtual spaces connected with intense extractive infrastructures. This land acknowledgement reminds me to act to further Indigenous sovereignty in the places that I call home. So we're going to screen share. Okay, so we're really excited to be here today. Thank you so much for the introductions. We're thrilled to be a part of the Georgetown-Oxford Collaborative Lecture Series, A Bent But Beautiful World, Literature, Art, and the Environment. Thanks so much to Catherine Temple and Mike Scott for the invitation, and to the Georgetown Office of the Vice President for Global Engagement for sponsoring, as well as the Future of the Humanities Project, the Georgetown Humanities Initiative, an MA program in the Engaged in Public Humanities, and Campion Hall and Las Casas Institute of Blackfriars Friars Hall in Oxford. Our thanks also to Mary Gordon, who is administering this webinar. What we thought we would do today is to start off our talk by sharing some brief background information on our collaboration and how we came to work on a People's Atlas of Nuclear Colorado. And then we'll give an overview and a live demo of the Atlas with time for discussion at the end. And we're really looking forward to hearing how this project resonates with the work that you're doing or teaching or your studies. So to begin, both Sarah and I had been working on the environmental aftermath of the Cold War in ways that combine scholarship and creative work.
So just about 10 years ago, we coalesced our overlapping interests in performative scholarship and the ethical and epistemological dimensions of toxicity to create a fictitious, but I would rather say wishful, government agency to address the ongoing legacies of the Cold War. This was called the National Toxic Land and Labor Conservation Service, which you see some images of on screen. And as agents of the service, we conducted tours, produced wishful government documents, such as the resolution in the upper right-hand corner, and reports, such as the one in the upper left-hand corner. Our primary activity was running a series of regionally specific workshops to collectively work through how to commemorate and publicly address the toxic legacies of the American Cold War and nuclear weapons complex. Through this work, we found that younger people, generally folks under 40, had very little knowledge of the Cold War, except as a series of discrete events and near but averted crises. Any awareness of the Cold War's ongoing slow violence was obscured by either just complete amnesia or had been transformed into a set of kind of kitschy pop cultural references. And that climate anxiety was overriding an earlier generation's fear of nuclear annihilation without very much analysis of how the two, you know, might be linked. At the same time, people who had devoted their entire lives to these issues tended to address them in very discrete ways. A particular issue, a particular site, a particular policy, where geographical, ideological, and issue boundaries tended to feel very firm. People would get involved at the scale where they felt effective, where they were most personally impacted, but they were often not aware or connected to others working on different aspects or geographies of the nuclear.
There was also an element of political timing to the evolution of our work on the TLC service and the transition from that to the Atlas. From the Obama administration's pursuit of smaller but no less deadly nuclear weapons designs to the Trump administration's push for next generation nuclear weapons, I could see within my immediate sphere in Washington, D.C., where I work in an interdisciplinary program within an international relations school, I could see a reinvigorated discussion of domestic uranium production, often with little knowledge of the actual status of mining and production sites across the U.S., many of which are 60 to 70 years old. And as someone who grew up near two of the major plutonium production sites in the country, Hanford, Washington in Washington State, and then Rocky Flats in Colorado, I took issue with this seemingly total lack of understanding of the basic conditions of these sites and their surrounding communities, ex-workers, affected environments, and regional economies. And with the scrubbing of government websites, the protection of basic information, as well as its accessible presentation, became crucial aspects of the project, along with the desire to knit together and link various aspects of the nuclear in a single platform. So we decided that the strategies of a wishful government agency with its collision of satire and sincerity was less effective to confront and contest cynicism and misinformation, as well as the continuation of an American paradigm committed to advancing nuclear capacities and the steadfast mounting arms race underlying each administration. So the shift to the Atlas project and format for us served as a way to first protect and share basic information as a buffer against disappearing data and propaganda here and afar. Second, we saw it as a way to dismantle the distancing of the Cold War as a remote era to the present. And finally, we also saw it as a way to instigate conversations about any hard or bright line between military and civilian applications of nuclear technology and what the Cold War reveals about this. And these latter two goals especially, I think, resonate with the current Biden administration, where we've seen the National Nuclear Security Administration's solicitation of up to 1 million pounds of domestically produced uranium this past July in 2022 to secure the country's uranium reserve and nuclear fuel supply chain, and simultaneously intensified efforts to extend the life of the US's aging nuclear power plants in response to climate change. Yet somehow these developments remain distant from the Cold War, even as Russia's nuclear weapons saber rattling and the targeting and occupation of Ukraine's Soviet era nuclear sites, including the Zaporizhzhia power plant and Chernobyl disaster area, reveal the weaponizing of Cold War legacies.
So we turn to an atlas specifically out of this performative community-based project, but aware of the longstanding use of critical and activist scholars in using atlases, both print atlases and digital atlas. We were drawn to the atlas as a really capacious form. It's not just a collection of maps, but generally contains illustrations, charts, and explanatory texts. It is also not a linear history, but an accumulation of artifacts, visualizations, and analysis that can skip forward and backward in time. The uncertain temporality of an atlas, atlases are both historic and present day documents, and the ethos of accumulation seem particularly appropriate at the level of form to an exploration of the nuclear. So we drew on this form as a way of collecting and cross-referencing many different types of content, different empirical registers, subjectivities, materials, voices, et cetera. True to form, we think of the atlas as a reference work designed to be viewed on a computer screen. You know, it's not a pocket map. It's not designed to help you find these locations in the field. So its interface has a book-like quality. We use the homepage, we kind of consider a table of context. It's horizontally oriented, images predominantly, and you kind of click through pages rather than continuously scroll through the content. So we're sort of drawing on a little bit of an adaptation of what we see as familiar print materials that condition digital atlases. So more than this collection of just sites in Colorado, the atlas is a curated collection of visual materials, which allow you to understand those sites in their aggregate. Includes an expanded geospatial archive, a lot of geolocated material on Google Maps, and then also presentations of historic artifact maps. It contains site histories, not just dots or points, so you can understand both the historic use and the evolution of these sites over time. It also contains issue briefs to provide context on policies, issues, practices, and histories. Then there are a few additional materials that are sort of less empirical. There are a collection, a few personal narratives, people who grew up in nuclear affected locations or military affected locations, reflecting on the impact on their lives that those landscapes have had. A collection of 12 scholarly essays, a really interdisciplinary group ranging from religious studies to history, to communications, environmental justice, et cetera. And then one of the more unusual editorial moves for an atlas, one that kind of exceeds the genre conventions of the atlas as a form, we decided to include contemporary artworks. These include installations, paintings, photographic projects, and poetry that address aspects of nuclear Colorado and related issues. So we turn to art as one of the few spaces that have social license to experiment with the contours of perception and propositions for different ways of seeing, feeling, and inhabiting the world. As artists and humanists, we feel strongly that nuclear issues can't be addressed just through policy or technology alone. So one of our primary goals has been to create this atlas as a collaborative platform for the arts, humanities, scholarships, and policy to be in a mutually generative dialogue, in order to open up new avenues for engagement and action. So the digital format of the atlas means that it's always open-ended. It's not a print book, it doesn't get editioned, and we still welcome contributions. No matter how long it gets, it will always be incomplete, always emergent, a people's atlas and not the people's atlas.
So before we turn to a live demonstration, there's the issue, why Colorado? Since the closure of the Rocky Flats plutonium plant nearly 30 years ago, Colorado has dropped off a lot of the most of the cartographic representations of the US nuclear complex. However, the state has encompassed almost all the stages of nuclear production and mobilization, from the mining of uranium to the assembly of weapons and the command and deployment of missiles. There are extensive already existing communities mobilized around these sites and issues in the state, but due to black boxing and compartmentalized governance, they remain fairly fragmented, localized efforts. So we wanted to build on local practices and on-the-ground experiences in a more connected way to challenge both the isolation of discrete campaigns and the abstracting aspatial discourse of energy and defense policy or even international relations. At the same time, we want to emphasize that Colorado specifically, and of course the United States generally, is itself an always already international space insofar as the continent has been indigenous land since time immemorial. Within the familiar territorial outlines of the US, there exist 574 indigenous nations with federal recognition of their sovereignty, as well as 200 unrecognized tribes. Many of these, most famously the Navajo, Diné, and Hopi nations, have been some of the most seriously impacted by so-called domestic uranium production. There are an estimated 500 to 1,000 abandoned uranium mines on the Navajo Nation, and some of the worst mine tailing disasters took place on Diné land. Moreover, Diné miners, who were rarely ever offered protective gear, traveled throughout the uranium belt, which encompasses Arizona, New Mexico, Utah, and Colorado, to work at off-reservation mines. And one of the most compelling current struggles over the nuclear legacy is the Ute Mountain Utes campaign to close the heavily polluting White Mesa uranium mill across the state border in Utah. Because the Ute Mountain Utes reservation includes land in both Colorado and Utah, we decided to include this site in the atlas, emphasizing that the received boundaries of the state of Colorado cannot contain either indigenous geographies or the toxic legacies of uranium processing. Finally, place attachment is real. We both have family in Colorado, and while we are remote from that place, we both have roots in Colorado and return frequently. Those territorial attachments are ethically important in that they ground us in this place and prevent us from treating it like a geographical abstraction. And in the context of nuclear policy discourse, this situated personal connection gives us a different standpoint in relation to this work. Okay, enough preamble. We're going to turn now to the actual site for a live demo, and I'm going to post the link to the Atlas site for those of you who might want to look at this while we continue.
While Shiloh is handling the screen share and posting the link, I want to just acknowledge that the Atlas was made possible by a grant from Georgetown University, the Pilot Research Grant Project, Northeastern University College of Art, Media, and Design Project Dissemination Grant, our own faculty development funds, and the labor of research assistants and designers often toiling at sub-market wages because this project became a lot bigger than we expected. And then we also had some curricular collaborations with the Public History Program at Northeastern University and with the Environmental Studies Program at Western Colorado University under Dr. Melanie Armstrong. So there's this project should be seen as we're here, but that has been touched by many, many hands. We have more than 40 collaborators and contributors at this point. So there are three primary ways to interact with the Atlas. You have this sort of universal search function with the magnifying glass. You can navigate to any of the content on a keyword basis. You can also navigate or browse via a map view, which has links to all material with geospatial coordinates, right? Not the policy or issue briefs, but you can see them sort of in relation to one another, zoom in, and you kind of become impressive visually through the just sheer density of nuclear sites in Colorado, but it provides very little context for what these sites are and what they are all doing in this place. So to provide that context, the privileged interface, the one that's the homepage, is a series of organized paths through the material. These are narrative arcs that place these sites in relation to and in a sequence with contextual issue briefs, interpretive essays, and artistic responses. Now, this path organization and the themes that each path develops is a direct rejoinder to the so-called nuclear fuel cycle and the cradle-to-cradle rhetoric that is the dominant way that that nuclear technology is presented in public policy discourse and in the sort of nuclear cheerleading industry, that this presents nuclear milling, enrichment, and reprocessing as a nearly inexhaustible circular process, sort of ultimate green technology. Shiloh is going to pull up some images to show you what we're talking about here.
So looking at mainstream representations of the nuclear fuel cycle, they typically suggest that there are these discrete phases that are conceptually, spatially, and temporally separated, and also that magically end with the creation of the nuclear product and fully containable or reprocessable waste. The fuel cycle is rendered either geometrically, as you're seeing here, these kind of spheres are very popular, or with a clip art aesthetic that domesticates the spaces of production. Both, you'll notice, make invisible workers, the earth, and communities. Most renditions of this process completely obscure the possibility of weapons and aver that energy is the real reason for the technology. And so our combination of these two processes in the Atlas is intentional, as their origins are entangled both technologically and historically. And we recently learned from Susan Gordon of New Mexico's Multicultural Alliance for a Safe Environment that they've been using the term nuclear fuel chain to emphasize both the fiction of clean reprocessing and the ways that the extraction and processing of radioactive materials binds communities and, in their words, brings us all down. I'm going to go back to the Atlas site now. As you can see here with our main table of contents, we adopt stages of the so-called fuel cycle, but we visually emphasize the linearity of the fuel chain, not the mythic circularity of the fuel cycle in the interface design. We also, you'll see, conceptually expand the phases to include the earth as the source of all matter and the socio-technical systems surrounding the nuclear. The beginning and the end points no longer refer solely to the technical production of nuclear products, but now extend to the natural geological processes and human social practices that support them. And finally, you'll see, and Sarah will expand on this, we pair each stage of the avowed or acknowledged part of the cycle, which we call the techno-utopian or positivist, with its shadow side or disavowed consequences.
Yeah. So as Shiloh said, each path has this slash in it, right? Separating the sort of positive techno-utopian and the shadow side of the particular stage in the nuclear fuel chain. This operates conceptually as well as navigationally to allow for different narrative content and sequences to emerge. So we have here on the left, pop production, the positive side, on the right, the shadow side. The techno-utopian is rendered in this blown out white, smooth, linear, seemingly clean and transparent aesthetics. So we're gonna start with the production side and then move over to the shadow. The first few essays of the production side explains how we are using the term nuclear weapons complex to refer to the entire set of far-flung facilities, collected technical expertise, and social investments in the nuclear enterprise, both during the height of production and at the present moment. So we can sort of get a sense of the extra beyond Colorado footprint of the nuclear complex. Next, we look at the overview of the industrial development and physical properties of plutonium, its environmental health effects, and the current issues and controversies surrounding this as a material. So what exactly is this material, plutonium, that we're talking about? So only after this broader context is provided will a user encounter the site description for Rocky Flats, which is arguably the most famous nuclear site in Colorado, a site description which discusses at a very kind of high level overview type detail the production of plutonium pits at the plant, the safety and environmental disasters that took place, the closure of the site and its transformation into a wildlife refuge. So Rocky Flats is notable because it has a place in both the techno-utopian side of the Atlas as well as in the shadow side. It is not the only site that has this ambiguity. And while the content of the site description remains the same, the color palette change signifies that the user has gone over into this shadow side. We use a kind of brown overview, and a lot of the colors of the site are actually drawn from soils and colors that are present in the landscape of the state of Colorado. On the shadow side, the identical Rocky Flat site description appears recontextualized by this color, suggesting that the shadow is ever present or merely a different way of viewing the same evidence, and placed then in context or in sequence with a radically different set of materials. So next in this version of the path is Allen Ginsberg, Plutonian Ode, a short essay on his classic poem that was that arose from his activism at Rocky Flats when he taught writing at Boulder's Naropa Institute. Next, we visit John Craig Friedman's first public art project, which was a series of billboards about nuclear waste produced at Rocky Flats that appeared on the highway directly outside the plant when it was still actively producing plutonium pits in the mid-1980s. The project was actually named Operation Green Run after a government's intentional release of radiation at Hanford in 1949. So suggesting that there's a sort of a willful exposure of the civilian population to these activities. The next essay goes into detail about the Rocky Flats raid and closure issue brief that speaks about the grand jury investigation, the fine and closure, and its eventual conversion to a wildlife refuge in much greater detail than the on-site overview. After that is a scholarly essay by Jen Richter, which examines the cover-up of the fires that destroyed the glove boxes where workers handled plutonium at Rocky Flats in the 1960s. This was a kind of could have been expected side effect of the purposeful trade-offs made by the Atomic Energy Commission, Dow, and plant owners who prioritized the production of nuclear materials over safety. We next see an artistic response by Idaho artist Amy O'Brien, an installation that simulates the radioactive debris from the Rocky Flats fires that was disposed of in a landfill in Idaho. She mixes industrial objects of the mid-20th century and actual artifacts from Rocky Flats with Cold War era popular culture, sort of inadequately contained within a rectangle of floor tape bearing hazardous waste warnings that in my mind are reminiscent of the edge of a domestic area rug. So again, we're sort of exceeding the boundaries of the state of Colorado here. And then finally, we get an issue brief on the legal regulations on nuclear materials, which was a very factual summary of the various national agencies and international agreements that regulate these materials. We want to be clear here that, and as I hope that the selection of materials indicates, that the shadow side is not the negative. It's not that everything that's bad about nuclear is in the shadow side. Rather, we understand it to be the material and political effects that generally go unrecognized by the dominant techno-utopian view of the nuclear. So we can think of friction both of the shadow side of production that includes the waste products of production itself, right? As well as the occupational illnesses that have arisen for workers. But we can also think of friction as the healthy democratic debate, reforms achieved through hard-fought activist campaigns and community organizing and mutual aid efforts that follow nuclear exposure.
So I'm going to quickly go back to the slides and just elaborate a little bit further on this. Rocky Flats is a relatively well-known nuclear site, especially in Colorado. But the Atlas includes many obscure and mundane places as well. And many of these sites in the Atlas are not found in spatial documentation of the US nuclear weapons complex. Nuclear Watch's interactive map of the weapons complex exemplifies the way official maps barely scratch the surface of the astonishingly deep-rooted and far-reaching economies, lands, and people involved in or subjected to some aspect of the nuclear enterprise. And you can note here on this map how Colorado's extensive participation does not even appear. The Atlas supplements and massively expands visual documentation of these activities that have deeply marked human lives and ecologies by including sites where there are few to no maps or Cold War acknowledgement. So heading back into the Atlas, I wanted to just quickly share a triptych. Let's see, Colorado School of Mines, where am I? Okay. So some of the most major educational and medical institutions in the US have direct links to the nuclear weapons and energy complex. For example, Colorado School of Mines once supported a research foundation that subcontracted for the Atomic Energy Commission, facilitating studies on domestic energy sources from coal and nuclear. And following the institute's expansion in the 1960s and eventual 1987 closure, at the Table Mountain Research Center, over 7,000 gallons of radioactive waste were released into Clear Creek, contaminating the drinking supply of an estimated 250,000 residents. The site is now used as a parking lot, soccer pitch, and recreational area, while remaining buildings at Table Mountain are leased for industrial use. More recently, technical expertise, such as that developed at the Colorado School of Mines, gets enacted in a complex dance between mandatory cleanup of shuttered mines and increasingly creative means of avoiding this. So the nearby Schwarzwalder mine exemplifies the strategy of maintaining mines on standby mode in order to avoid cleanup, despite mounting environmental violations. At one time producing 99% of all uranium in the Front Range area at the largest vein type uranium deposit in the country, the mine was declared a Superfund site in 1984 due to contamination of nearby creeks and the Ralston Reservoir, which provides drinking water for 1.3 million Denver metro residents. The previous mine owner Cotter Corporation used a legal loophole, to keep the mine open on intermittent status, even as uranium levels and water supplies reached over 1,000 times higher than state standards across the decade from 2000 to 2010. And in a recent twist, the mine sold to Colorado, a company called Colorado Legacy, to be converted into an eco-friendly recreational space. And one final site, shifting to a different part of the state in the Northeast with Wyoming and Nebraska to the traditional and ancestral homeland of the Arapaho, Cheyenne, Lakota, and Pawnee, the Pawnee National Grassland hosts cattle grazing, hiking, wind power generation, hydraulic fracturing, and active nuclear missile sites, all within a few miles of each other. And affiliated with the Warren Air Force Base just across the Wyoming border, an estimated 150 nuclear missiles sprawl underground on hair trigger alert. In an underground set of launch control centers, two-person crews wait around the clock, as they have for 50 years, for a presidential order to launch nuclear war. These active northeastern Colorado missile silos remain a focal point for anti-war and anti-nuclear activism. And what you're looking at here is one of the scholarly essays that talks about this region.
Okay, so I'm gonna return to the talk a little bit more in detail about art as and why we have decided to include that in this. So we have separate paths for both the scholarly essays and the artwork. And we're gonna share just two pieces slightly greater detail. So Mallory Quitocki's works, DNA Damage and DNA Repair, show the wrecking ball damage of chemical carcinogens, radiation, and other atmospheric pollutants at the level of strands of DNA. So she draws on designs from Native communities of the Southwest to convey the intimate connection between their body, culture, and vulnerability. So in one of these paintings, we see DNA's ability to be destroyed by nuclear hazard signs. And then in the second, the companion piece, she is also drawing an analogy between the intricate skill of Native beadwork and the capacity of the body and traditional foods to actually repair. Implying that biology is deeply cultural, the artwork depicts DNA damage and repair as an intimate and intergenerational process of reckoning and creative reuse. I know she is a public health artist in residence and activist who works with Indigenous communities and in the Southwest, most notably the Navajo and Hopi, and has been using these as a form of kind of community awareness raising and mobilizing and education, hope providing in the context of her work. So another Atlas artwork is entitled Open Care by Eric Berger and Marie Kito, which propose a project that is conceptual and proposes a thought experiment. What if nuclear waste were a very personal responsibility and part of our everyday lives? So they build on Joanna Massey's concept of nuclear guardianship to imagine that nuclear waste could be distributed globally as artfully encapsulated pieces of jewelry or objects that would become the personal belongings of individuals to be cared for as an inherited responsibility passed down through generations, hundreds of generations. This hypothetical calling augurs a new way of understanding nuclear futures that's not limited to any specific opinion or nuclear policy position, right? Instead, the artwork invites the audiences to consider an active, personalized relationship of care for nuclear materials, avoiding a reductive pro or con debate around these things. It simply exists, and we are always already inside the nuclear and responsible for it, whether we acknowledge that responsibility or not. In this way, this artwork powerfully reorients social and spatial and political divisions around what nuclear custodianship might be and what repairs might be possible and just. So I said before that art was one of these only spaces of practice with a social license to experiment with the contours of perception and propositions for different ways of seeing, feeling, and inhabiting the world. So some of the artworks in the Atlas, like Pataki's and Berger Kito's, envision mechanisms for healing from and caring for nuclear waste. Others are monuments to specific toxic sites. They comment through visual means on legacies of absence, abandonment, and amnesia. They operate in this way less at the register of argument and evidence, no matter how important we find that to be, and more in terms of affect and aesthetic. Now, we understand the aesthetic as less what's subjectively pleasing or beautiful, and more as what Jacques Rancière has called the distribution of the sensible, or what the cultural common sense allows us to sense, perceive, and express. For that reason, aesthetics is fundamental to our capacity to apprehend the world, including what is literally invisible and what has been invisibilized, like the nuclear itself. These art projects are more oblique than addressing nuclear issues through policy alone, but we believe that putting these works in proximity to humanity scholarship and policy, new avenues for engagement and action emerge.
So in closing, nuclear governance has forced compartmentalization that has made it more difficult for activisms around nuclear issues to make connections and offer more comprehensive critique. Different sites aren't contextualized in relation to the overall governance of the US nuclear complex and often remain dislocated from each other. They appear in isolation at different stages in the process, and knowledge has been black boxed to such a degree, activists, scholars, and artists usually address sites separately. So the Atlas responds to the idea of the fuel chain as one way to understand the sites in relation to each other within the production process and nuclear governance. In this way, the interface is the argument. We provide dots on the map, but that is not adequate context, so the Atlas also provides spatial narratives. And because our rendition flattens the fuel cycle into the fuel chain while expanding to include its shadow, geological materiality, and cultural political struggle, it challenges at the level of form and interface the fictive tidiness of containment culture. We want the Atlas in all its emergent, not yet completeness to serve as a civic infrastructure, allowing contributors to better position their sites, issues, or research in a larger framework conditioned by nuclear governmentality, but never fully reducible to it. We will stop there and look forward to comments, questions, and discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was just, you know, it's a brilliant project and a wonderful presentation. And I have a feeling that we could have gone, you know, much longer in terms of digging down into the website. There's so much material there. I really admire how you've managed like the surface of the website and then the deeper textual and artistic elements and the kind of layering that you've done, because as you know, a lot of these sort of academic websites often end up with a lot of print, right? But you kind of gently lead the observer into that. So that's very admirable. But you know, the thing that really struck me was the humanities, people keep saying the humanities is dead, you know, humanities is over. And what I saw here was an alternative to the traditional view of the humanities as always looking at history, always looking at the past, the canon, et cetera, et cetera. And the alternative seems to be the humanities as a way of imagining alternative futures in light of a very deep knowledge of the history, the science, and the background of whatever the area is. So I wondered if you were exercising that in the website in a very deliberate manner, or is this some, you know, a movement in this field? I'm just very interested in that.
Either. With two people, it's always not sure.
Sorry, yeah. Oh, I mean, I think, you know, as we explained with the earlier TLC project, that engaged very much in a kind of parafictional practice. I actually can't recall who has said that. Sarah, do you remember?
Oh, Carrie Lambert, baby.
That's right, Carrie Lambert. Yeah. Yeah, a kind of parafictional practice that's about this kind of trying to enact or rehearse or engage in activities that lead to a different way of governing or enacting the world. Defamiliarizing routinized responses and different genres of response, and kind of trying to world or rehearse or practice, engage in the kind of different futures that we would like to see, and in doing so to kind of seed new understandings and build relationships. And so I think that's where the Atlas really picks up on that too, in a different way, where the kind of interface itself and the way that we are expanding that fuel cycle into the chain and kind of drawing in all of these kind of aggregating, it has this kind of aggregating activity, this constant doing, right? So that the Atlas seemingly, you go to the website and then it seems like it's finished, but it actually has an aggregating function as a people's Atlas to continue to add to it. And in that sense, we see it as a way also to seed new understandings, to possibly build new relationships across disparate issues, different sites, through this kind of interface design and way that it operates as kind of a platform that allows, as we say in geography, to jump scale. People can kind of jump scale, they can connect up into this other scale. We saw that with our agency too, the National TLC Service, that was kind of like this fictitious wishful government agency that allowed for different folks and different sites, different issues to kind of use that as a public making platform. And so I think that the Atlas in just a really different way, similarly allows for this kind of, it organizes a different orientation and a possible platform for engagement across these really different issues and sites. So I think what's also interesting and important about that is the polyvocal nature of it too. Where it can have, it doesn't opt for like a consensus necessarily, a forced consensus. It actually has different points of view up there. And I think that's another key aspect of it, to kind of critique this sort of desubjectified policy voice, right? And kind of in these aspatial discourses by having this kind of polyvocal aggregating work. And what you don't see, I think, unless you look at the collaborator page and see there's like, you know, 47 or I don't even remember how many collaborators we're up to now, unless you look at that, you know, part of looking at the website is you don't actually see is that it really is an active doing, right? It's both a thing that you can look at, a digital humanities project, it's up there, but there's this active nature to it, this kind of activity. It's an activity. I'll stop there. And I think it also contests, and this is maybe something that it might rub the wrong way with some of the ongoing ideas in the humanities about the kind of individual researcher, right? Like this really challenges the idea of a sovereign individual researcher. And I've always found that really interesting that humanities often still, in the sciences, you see all these kind of collaborations. I think there's a lot of collaborations, I mean, in social practice wise in the humanities, but I do think this one is definitely on that side that's moving away from, you know, an individual researcher to kind of this activity and constant doing. Sarah, I'm sure you have other great things to say too here.
So I wanted to sort of talk a little bit about this project as a digital / public humanities project, because I think it's really important to think about it as both things, that something is that is digital, a project isn't digital just because it uses digital tools or digital modalities. It is also digital in that it is a site of access and participation, remote participation from audiences. And in that way, we're less interested in sort of big data approaches to humanity and more things that leverage the capacity of communications technologies to facilitate wide-ranging participation and collaboration and access to materials that otherwise might not be accessible. So this is completely free and open to the public. We intentionally did not engage in practices of peer review, rather instead in practices of sort of like editorial collaboration with a lot of the contributors, right, in order to emphasize the kind of public nature of the digital platform. So we have contributors who are academics, we have contributors who are, undergraduate students, right, or at the time of their contribution, and people who are non-academics. Mm-hmm. As well. So that was really important for us. And similarly, those relationships are what makes it public, not the fact that it's a website. Right? So we wanted to kind of like probe a little bit about what this project could do if we thought about it as digital/public and not either digital or not just public. The other thing that I wanted to say related to the humanities and the sort of the perpetual but always accelerating crisis of the humanities is that the humanities is a form of a way of knowing that acknowledges that it's about world making, and a lot of other areas of academic inquiry disavow the way it's about world making, right? Or that there is an epistemic stake in it. And that world making is also a site of contestation. And so I see the varied materials that we have aggregated as being about saying like, so this is a world that's been made. It's been made through different discourses. Let's present them, put them together, sift through them, because the world that has been made also can be made otherwise, right? Can't be unmade, right? But it can be made anew, right? And we don't direct people to a particular destination, but we try to provide the impetus to do that work imaginatively.
Thank you for that. I'm teaching a public humanities outreach course down at our other campus at the CALL program in the fall, and I already know this is going to be part of an assignment. So that was just the way that you have thought through these issues is going to be so helpful to the students. I really appreciate it. We do have a question from someone. We now have a couple of questions in the Q&A. The first one is from Frank Dersitis. Power is not given away easily. Boy, we know that, right? Did you encounter any resistance to your publicizing this kind of information? And I'll let you decide who might respond.
I think in some ways there's the second question, I think we can kind of aggregate those. So the second question actually asked about, so how do US authorities or departments see the Atlas? Is there any factual and helpful interactions or do they simply tolerate our research? I think that those both speak a little bit to the interface mm-hmm. between government, right, and a citizens initiative, right, such as this. I think it's really important to recognize, right, that the government is heterogeneous, right? Mm-hmm. Powers that be do not speak with one voice. Particularly with the Atlas, our sources, we're very much relying on government information, sources of government information, right? Mm-hmm. Much of which is parceled out across a dozen different agencies, federal, state, local, and many times people don't know what's not in their jurisdiction, right? So we haven't had a lot of direct contact with agencies in the assembly of the Atlas. We did have contact with people working at different scales of government when we were doing the National Toxic Land and Labor Conservation Service. And there's always people in those settings who are curious, helpful, eager to work with you, people who are skeptical, people who don't get it, right? There can be a wide range of responses when you're dealing with individual civil servants. We haven't received like a cease or desist or anything like that. And I think what we're trying to do is bring aggregate materials into one space, right? So something that you might need to go to the Colorado Department of Environmental Protection and the Office of Legacy Management to learn about, right, can be in one site. So that's like a useful contribution. But we're also not presenting or pretending that this is the only source of information. So we link extensively to official government websites that tend to present things in a much more kind of technical, technocratic language that can be more difficult for a general public to access or parse. So I see them as complementary. And definitely want to like elevate the many people who are working in bureaucracies, who are people who still have agency, right, and who exercise that agency on a daily basis.
I don't have heaps to add. That was really thorough. Thank you, Sarah. I just really did want to emphasize again the heterogeneity of government offices and agencies. And then you have, you know, different people in those agencies. Part of what we're doing, as you heard us describe and putting all of this together, is to, I think, you know, work against this compartmentalization of knowledge. And that is actually something that, you know, can help agencies themselves, because they're very kind of contained in their own mandates. So many have been very generous with materials. And I think, you know, that's actually an aspect that can be helpful to the sort of government agencies themselves, is to see, you know, their work or the work, not their, you know, the work of that agency then in this larger context. So we haven't received any. I think in an earlier piece, the main concern was using a logo from the Department of, one of the offices in the Department of Energy that no longer exists or has ceased to really have much of an online presence. But the main concern there was just an unauthorized, you know, what are you using the logo for? So, which has been interesting to see that as being maybe one concern.
So I see this as a very transdisciplinary project, right? And I'm sure you do too. And I was wondering though about what seems like a compartmentalization of the art, the literature, and the sort of science, history of science, geography side of this. And I just wondered if you could talk a little bit about that and if you thought of alternatives to that.
Could you restate that? Do you mean that? Do you want us to talk about the transdisciplinary nature or resistance we've had to that, or?
I'm just looking at the website based on what you presented today, but it seemed like there were different paths. One was more historical, science, geographical, right, and the other one was more art, literature, and I just wondered, is there a way to merge those two or to create interactions between those two, other than like in the art itself, like in this wonderful, were they the DNA damage, DNA repair, you see that merge.
Right. Yeah.
So I think that some of that might be the specific paths that we showed, but right, mostly, yeah. So the privileged way of interacting with the Atlas content is through these paths that relate to the nuclear fuel cycle or nuclear fuel chain. And that presents information in order that includes site descriptions, issue briefs, which are often of a kind of policy or technoscience background information, with scholarly essays and with art, right? So you'll just be looking through a sequence of material and there'll be no necessary division according to like kind of type of knowledge that you have. In addition to those sites, we also have just a collection of the scholarly essays and just a collection of the artwork, with an understanding that some people are going to want to be able to kind of jump to that material rather than looking at things in this kind of nuclear production fuel chain kind of set of metaphors.
Okay.
Yeah. That's so I started screen sharing again just so we could show. One of the things we didn't talk about is we have these icons that allow you to shift between too. So there is an essay path, there is the artwork path, but actually these sort of, you know, along the nuclear fuel chain, there's a commingling of all of these materials without giving primacy to any specific content, right? They're kind of in there. We were looking at production friction. So you'll see, you know, here's a, that's an issue brief, that's an essay, artwork, site, you know, there's site-based ones. So there's a commingling inside of those narrative pathways that kind of reject the disciplinary compartmentalization by putting them in kind of adjacent.
Okay, so that's super helpful. I see that Mike's back, but I just did want to get in one word for about my admiration for the way you kind of brought book and digital together, right? I'm really interested in book history, and I love the idea that we have lost book when we've gone digital, but you've expanded on it and created this participatory environment that goes beyond the sort of physical nature of the original book. So thank you for that. Just wonderful presentation, and I'll turn it back over to Mike.
Yes, thank you very much. It's been a fascinating afternoon listening to you. Of course, talking to you from across the seas, as it were. This isn't just something that is isolated to the United States. This is a world issue, and an incredibly serious world issue at the present time. It's a matter of how, through art, I think through art and the humanities, that we try to get messages across. As this is all going on, the big image that kept coming into my mind was Picasso's Guernica, to be perfectly honest. Mm-hmm. And what that demonstrated way back. But in my lifetime, I was born just 4 years after the first atomic bomb was dropped. I lived through that whole kind of period of the Cold War. I lived through that fear. And I also lived through the history of two world wars in which my relations have been involved and some had in fact died. So this whole thing is a massive world issue now. It's no longer an issue for the United States or for Europe or for Britain. It's so big that somehow we've got to encompass it and find ways which have communications which go beyond the written word, go beyond even an atlas in one sense, to be able to make statements which people can respond to wherever they are. But as I speak, people are fleeing from Sudan, and that whole area is in huge danger. So I think what you're doing is terrific. I think it's fabulous in terms of the communication, in terms of the mixing with the digital, with the humanities, the traditional humanities. I think that's wonderful. But I think when we're doing these things, we have to think of how we're going to get messages across. Otherwise, there won't be anything for anybody to consider. That's the truth of it.
Yeah, I think this is such a great model for other academics, other activists to be exposed to. I wonder, well, we've only got maybe 2 minutes left here, but perhaps in the future, we could talk about, you know, how extensive your networks are and how you're reaching out to, you know, others who are also interested in this across the globe. So,
my wife comes from a village which is right next door to one of the oldest nuclear plants in the UK. In fact, when you look out of the windows of her house, we can see the plant being decommissioned. How is it being decommissioned? and what is happening, or what did happen within the seas around us as well. So it's poignant. I'm not saying these things in any way to go against what you've been saying today. I think it's been terrific, mm-hmm. but it's made my mind because I'm not in America and this isn't my doorstep to think globally, to think of what is happening, and you've actually sparked that off in my mind. So thank you very much. So thanks to both of you. I have to bring it all to a close now, but thanks to both of you. Thank you, Catherine, for conducting the panel discussion in such a good way today. Our next event in this series is on Tuesday, the 2nd of May, when a younger Oxford graduate student doing her doctorate at the moment will be discussing, going right the way back. She's going to be discussing the creation and the environment as described in Old English literature. So little of Old English is taught these days, and yet it's got a lot to teach us, as was shown when we had a conference in Oxford between Georgetown and ourselves just in December. So she's going back to the 8th, 9th, and 10th century, and people might say, oh, we don't want to listen to this either. This isn't the thing to listen to. Please tune into this. It's going to be really interesting. And if you want to hear how the language was spoken, go to that because she's absolutely brilliant at speaking that language. So it'll open up new vistas, I'm sure, for many people, as today has. On Wednesday, May the 3rd, it is World Press Day, and we have a Zoom, which you might like to know. It's in the Free Speech at the Crossroads International Dialogues event in association with the Future of the Humanities. And we'll be talking about the freedom of the press in the democratic world. Or is it a freedom? That's what we'll be talking about. That's at the usual time at 4 p.m. And we've got some wonderful speakers lined up for you for that. But today we would like to thank those at Georgetown University who have made all these things happen, especially Julie Murillo and Mary Gordon. We'd like to thank, of course, Jack DeJoy, the president, and Tom Banchoff, vice president, global affairs. At Campion Hall, Nick Austin, the master of the hall, and Ying Ying Gao, Campion Hall administrator. At Blackfriars, Richard Finn, the director of the Las Casas Institute, John O'Connor, the regent of the hall, and Kinga Rona Gabnai, our administrator. My thanks to Maggie, my wife, Maggie Scott, for all the help she gives me in arranging these, as I do to thank again Catherine for all her help in the series that we put on. So remember that our next free speech session is on Wednesday, the 22nd of May. It's on the free speech one. Is on May the 3rd, and remember, please, to tune in to our next session in Literature, Art and Environment, which is actually next Tuesday with Jasmine Jones. In the meantime, everybody keep safe, take care. Shiloh, Sarah, many, many thanks for a very enlightening afternoon. And Catherine, thank you. Take care, everybody. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.